Welcome to another episode of Hello CISO. And in this episode, we're going to be talking about something that many people have many strong opinions on, and that is 2FA or two-factor authentication. If you've been paying any attention whatsoever over the last few years, you might have seen a bit about 2FA, and you may even believe that 2FA is the answer to all of our security problems. It is, of course, a bit more nuanced than that. So let's dive into it and see what two-factor actually brings to the table. At first glance, two-factor authentication does seem like the answer to all of our security problems. Certainly, if you glance the headlines, you'll see that suggestion time and time again. Microsoft has said that less than 0.1% of all accounts using multi-factor authentication, so two factors or more, suffer from account takeover. And that is an exceptionally low number. Google has said that adding a recovery phone number to your Google account can block up to 100% of automated bot attacks, 99% of phishing attacks, and 66% of highly targeted attacks. Again, very impressive numbers, this time from Google. Wirecutter has said that the most important thing you can do to enhance your online security, after using a password manager, of course, is to turn on two-factor authentication. And again, we get this really positive endorsement of using 2FA. Those statements are accurate. But one of the very important things to understand is that 2FA is not necessarily the best security mechanism in every context. And it really depends on the circumstances in which it's being used. If you think you're immune to attack just because you've deployed 2FA, think again. Because just as the security controls are evolving, so are the phishers. Now, I'll give you an example of where it can go wrong. Let's imagine a scenario where someone authenticates to a service using a username and password. The service then asks for a code to be entered. So, for example, from a physical token. The code is entered, and if everything works correctly, the user is authenticated. Phishers have evolved such that phishing pages which ask for a username and password, are now relaying those to the service which they're impersonating. That service then asks for a code. So the phishing page asks for a code. The user enters the code into the phishing page, and it then gets relayed to the service they're authenticating to. So all that's happening here is the phishers are evolving to replicate the normal authentication flow on the legitimate site. So this also demonstrates how 2FA is not foolproof. Now that also raises a very important point. Not all 2FA is equal. So let's talk about four different types of 2FA, each with their own pros and cons. The one most people are probably familiar with is SMS-based 2FA. So you log into a website, it sends you an SMS. You get the SMS from your phone, you relay it into the website, and you log in. Two big problems with that. Number one, we have SIM hijacking. So an attacker very often socially engineering a telco to port someone's phone number to another device. So now the attacker receives the SMS. So now they really only have one factor. They just need the username and the password, and then the attacker can receive the SMS. That's problem number one. Problem number two is that it is phishable. So the phishing website can ask for the username and password, send them to the legitimate site, wait for the SMS to be sent to the victim, and then the phishing site simply asks for the value that was in the SMS. So SMS is a fallible 2FA implementation. Moving on to the second implementation of 2FA, we have soft tokens. So this is an app which displays a code which rotates. Now the problem with soft tokens is that they're still phishable in the way that SMSs are. The phishing website can ask for the username and password, relay those to the site it's impersonating, and then say, okay, now just give me the value in the soft token. They can still trick the victim. Number three, we have hard tokens. So tokens with numbers that rotate over them, and you hold it in your hand, little plastic battery-powered device normally. Same problem as soft tokens, still phishable. And then all the way at the upper end of the 2FA spectrum, we have U2F. And U2F keys are physical devices, normally that you either insert via USB or they work wirelessly via NFC or Bluetooth. These are very clever cryptographic devices that you must have present on you. And the great thing about them is that they are not phishable. They don't have any display on them. They don't create a number that you have to enter. You have to have the physical device in addition to your username and password. So 2FA doesn't protect against all threats. There are still bypasses to 2FA. There are places where it is insufficient. Now, they are very, very specific instances, but the important thing to remember is that 2FA is not a foolproof security technology. So, should you deploy 2FA? Well, the answer is a little bit unsatisfying. It depends. It depends not only on the threats you're already protecting against, but the threats that you expect to be vulnerable to. There's still no replacement for using unique random passwords generated by a password manager. That is still your best line of defense. I've often heard people say that if they turn on 2FA, the strength of their password doesn't really matter anymore. It doesn't matter if it's not unique and random. And this really just doesn't make any sense because that doesn't give you 2FA. That gives you, let's call it about 1.5 FA. The whole premise of 2FA is to have two factors that are as strong as they can be. You must absolutely still have a strong, unique, randomly generated password from your password manager, and then you turn on your 2FA as well. Don't skimp on one just because you have the other. That said, 2FA can be a worthwhile supplement, especially as an alternative to outdated security protocols such as arbitrary password complexity criteria and length and mandated rotation. Because none of those things work if the attacker has the exact password that the user has used. So for example, in a phishing attack or a credential stuffing attack. And then we get to the real challenge in 2FA, and that's the user experience and the impact on productivity. By design, that second factor is there to make things difficult. Now, yes, ideally make things difficult for the attacker, but by its very nature, it also makes it difficult for the people who have to live with 2FA just to log into their accounts. Security is very often at odds with usability, and two-factor is a perfect example of where that happens. People aren't real keen on having to go and dig that key out of their wallet or wait for that SMS to arrive. They can't just log in. Putting barriers in their way does impact their productivity. In survey after survey, IT professionals do report pushback from users when they attempt to implement 2FA, simply because it does get in the way of user productivity. So this is really a much larger discussion than just the security pros of 2FA. We can't ignore the impact on the humans that are there to use the system. And this is where 2FA does get a bit of negative press. In a report commissioned by SecureAuth and Core Security, and this was reported on by Tech Republic, 63% of companies say employees won't use multi-factor authentication. The pushback makes sense. In a large organization with a long tenured Active Directory installation, the rollout of MFA can be considered unacceptable in terms of the impact on productivity. But the fact remains that those looking for a silver bullet are unlikely to find it in 2FA. Should you turn on 2FA when you are given the option to protect your account? Well, yes, unquestionably, I do this myself with every single account. But should an organization roll it out org-wide and mandate that every single person use it? That's a much trickier question to answer. To answer this question, you really need to consider the types of attacks that you're currently protecting against and the ones that you remain vulnerable to. If you're still vulnerable to the types of attacks that 2FA do protect against, then that's probably a good point to start having the discussion about the role that it could play within your organization. There's a balance to be had, and this is precisely why the role of IT leadership is forming into a trusted partnership with the business. Understanding business goals and working together to achieve the optimal balance between security and usability is the next frontier for IT. If you've enjoyed this video as part of the Hello CISO series, then please give it a like and subscribe to the 1Password YouTube channel for more videos like this.